Laurel Clark.
Thanks, Mike. My name's Laurel Clark. I'm the other Navy physician on board this flight. I come here with a background working on Navy submarines and with Navy divers, and also with Marine Corps aviators. I'm obviously thrilled to be on this mission. It's my first mission, and besides being able to work on all the payloads, mostly back in the Space Habitable Research Module, I'll also have an opportunity to help out on the flight deck as a flight engineer when we come home for entry. And that's about all I need to say, because we've had a lot of other good words. To my right is our seventh crew member, Ilan Ramon from Israel.
And my name is Ilan Ramon. I'm an Israeli Air Force pilot representing the Israeli Space Agency. And it's going to be my first flight, hopefully not the last flight. I'll be taking part in a variety of experiments on board the STS-107, including the MIDEX, the Israeli experiment, which hopefully will enable us to better understand Earth climate and Earth and global warming and cooling. Also, I'll be taking care of several students' experiments. Those students come out of Australia, China, Japan, Israel, and the United States, and it's been a pleasure. It's going to be a pleasure for me to conduct and to participate with the students in research in space. And since nobody is on my right, I'm going to pass it to you back, Rick.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I'll go ahead, Rick, unless you have another comment.
That's fine.
Okay. We'd like to begin with questions here at the Johnson Space Center. Who'd like to step up first? Okay, back here, Bill, please.
Bill Harwood, CBS. I apologize for all of us being buried back over here by the moat box. I'm confused on flight engineers. Can you explain the shifting? And I guess, who is KC flight engineer going up and Laurel's flight engineer going down? Did I hear that right? Or can you just talk about that? I heard three people say they were flight engineers. So
Laurel and I are swapping.
Okay. So you're
KC's prime.
KC is the prime engineer.
Prime engineer, and then there's kind of the deputy flight engineer, and that's my own term. That's not really a NASA term, but
okay.
I'm to the right of KC behind Willie. But the prime flight engineer is KC uphill and downhill, and then Laurel and I swap. I'm going up, she's coming down.
I'm with you now. I just got confused by three people saying they were flight engineer. One for Mr. Ramon. I guess, you know, a lot of American reporters obviously have an increased interest because of your presence on the crew. Can you maybe just talk a little bit about any discussions you guys have had about, I mean, do you view this as your presence on this crew making any additional risk from a security standpoint for NASA to deal with, or anything like that you guys might have talked about, or what your thoughts are?
I think my presence in the crew, in this wonderful crew, is just another crew member. And as you know, we have several Israeli experiments on board, and there's no talks about any other than the usual risks after September 11.
All right, next, Mark.
Thank you, Mark Corot from the Houston Chronicle. For the commander, could you talk a little bit about what it's sort of like to be on deck but still have kind of a question mark as to whether you get to fly next or wait? How do you guys kind of dealing with that, or keeping yourself ready and wondering if you won't have to stand down for a little while?
Well, there's an adage in the astronaut office that says probably the best thing to be able to go do in the astronaut office is to go fly a mission. The next best thing after that is being assigned to a mission. So we're thrilled to death to be not only assigned but also be the next crew up. And we have had a fair number of slips through the course of our training, but we've made good use of those in preparing for the flight. Also having the opportunity to go do an outdoor leadership school together as a crew, which I think helped us tremendously. And so in each case where we've had something like this come up, we've been able to put it to very good use. And this will be no exception. So we will take a little bit of time off, and then we'll be coming back, and just picking up where we left off with our training and doing the final preparations up to launch.
Jim?
Yeah, Jim Oberg with ABC News. For Mike Anderson about the research program. Mike, how does the research program on this mission mesh with the research on the International Space Station? And how would you compare in terms of what are the strengths of this kind of mission versus the strengths of the International Space Station for science research?
That's a good question. You know, this flight is really a bridge between the shuttle research program and the new research that we're doing on the International Space Station. And the two research programs really complement each other. You know, with the shuttle, we get something that we don't get with the International Space Station. That's a quick return. We're able to fly the mission, this mission 16 days, and then return the science back to Earth for the investigators to look at. And for some investigations and some scientific endeavors, that's exactly what you want. You want to be able to get up there and get your science done and get it back on the ground and look at it again. Another thing we get with the space shuttle is that allows us to test out our theories. You know, if a scientist has an idea about something, he can develop his hardware and develop his ideas. He can fly it on the shuttle, get it back, see if it worked. If it didn't work, he can change his parameters. He can redesign his hardware and make fixes and fly it again, and then again if he needs to, and then perfect it. Then once he's perfected that hardware and once he's perfected his ideas, then he can translate that to the International Space Station, where he can then conduct research over a long period of time. So really working together, the two programs, the space shuttle as a quick return vehicle and as a vehicle that allows us to develop and perfect our scientific endeavors. And then the space station, a long-term research facility with vast quantities of space and power and an ability to really do research in depth and over a long period of time.
All right, back here in the corner, please.
My name is Michelle Casas. I'm with Fox 26 News in Houston. And I wanted to hear from some of the other astronauts. I know that Mr. Ramon didn't talk about any increased risk pertaining to this flight. Is there any concern from any of the other astronauts?
Just taking a look down the line, I don't really think there is, to be honest with you. We're very confident with all the measures that have been taken, both with the hardware, when we talk about the inspections they're doing on the engines, as well as we are with security. And we have every confidence in all the people who are working on those issues, and they all have them very well in hand.
And just to add to that, you know, one thing that happens when you're assigned to a flight like this is you really sort of get blinders on. You get focused so hard on what you're doing until you really are just concerned about what you're working on and what your mission is. And we've been training for this flight for over 2 years, and it's really, you know, consumed a lot of our time and a lot of our effort. And when we heard about the slip coming up with the engines, you know, it was disappointing for some, but I'm sure for a lot of people in the science community, you know, there were a lot of sighs of relief. It gives us a little extra time to work on our payloads and to perfect things. So we're going to take advantage of every moment we have to make this an even better, more successful flight.
All right.
I have two questions. One as an Israeli and one other as one who interested in science. As an Israeli, how is Mr. Ramon got into the crews? How you got him? How is the relationship between you? It's open for everybody.
I'll answer that one. I think we as a crew have embraced Elon because he's such a wonderful individual, regardless of nationality. He's just been a true pleasure to have. Rick mentioned that we went on a Knowles expedition together, an outdoor leadership expedition, and that was our first opportunity together as a crew to really bond not only amongst the U.S. crew members, but collectively amongst the U.S. and Israeli crew member, and it's just been wonderful ever since then. So he's a hard charger, wonderfully warm and personable, and because of that, I think without question, across the board, we've all come to embrace and love Elon. So.
Okay. The other question is regarding that the space has been researched for more than 40 years, and it's still mostly government-owned in all over the world, not only in the U.S. We start now to see tourism, the seeds of tourism in space. What do you think about privatizing space and the opportunity of tourism?
Again. Dave, you want to talk about that one?
Well, I think it's been talked about at the highest levels of NASA that our job is to do things that aren't always viable in commercial industry, and that when something does become commercially viable, it is time to hand it off. But for things that don't always easily generate a profit, that are either too risky or just a little bit too complex, that's kind of what we're going to be doing. So the fact that there's a lot of government money that comes into not only our flight, but NASA as a whole is really very consistent with our mission as an organization. As far as the role of space tourism, that's really not part of our particular flight, and I don't really think it's something that we would really be qualified to talk about. I mean, it's not part of our particular flight. We're a science research flight. And I'll hand it over to Rick or somebody else.
Okay. Next up, up here. Where's my mic handler? I'm sorry. Yeah, right here. Thank you.
David Santucci with CNN. My question is for Mr. Ramon. What does it mean to you to be the first Israeli astronaut? What do you think it means to the people of Israel? And I believe before you even said that this was symbolic for the Jewish people as a whole. Can you comment about that?
Yes, of course, every time you're the first, it's meaningful. And to be the first Israeli astronaut is meaningful to a lot of people. I believe all the people of Israel. It's also meaningful for a lot of the Jewish community throughout the world. And probably the fact that I'm a son of a Holocaust survivor is even more symbolic than the usual. So you kind of can think about it as I carry on the suffer and whatever the Holocaust generation went through, and I'm kind of a proof that even though all the hard time they went through, we are going forward.
All right. Seeing no additional questions here, I'd like to go back to Kennedy Space or go to Kennedy Space Center next. I know we have five media there.
This is Phil Chen, Earth News. Doug, we always love it when you come back here. And shalom, hello, and I guess for Rick, howdy. For Mike Anderson from KREM in Spokane, Washington, can you talk about growing up in the Cheney Spokane area? Any thoughts about growing up there and becoming steps that helped you become an astronaut?
Well, hello, first of all. Yeah, I did grow up in Spokane, Washington. That's my home. My parents still live there. And Spokane, for those who don't know, is in the Pacific Northwest, and I think it's one of the most beautiful parts of this country. It's absolutely gorgeous up there, great forest and mountains, and just a very nice place to live. And growing up there was a wonderful time, wonderful opportunity to live in that part of the country as a young child and have an opportunity to experience all the things that that part of the country has to offer. I really enjoyed growing up there and always enjoy getting back to Spokane every couple of years and visiting my parents and seeing how things have changed and how things have not changed and what good things are still there. I went to high school in Cheney, Washington, which is a small town just outside of Spokane. An excellent high school, had a great time there, and you know, it helped me make my dreams come true, so I can't say enough about the high school there and all the teachers and educators there in Cheney. So I'd just like to say hello to everyone back in Spokane and in Cheney.
And for Dave Brown, you're getting to live the ultimate dream of every kid twice. What was it like when you told your family and friends, I'm going to run away and join the circus? And what was it like when you told your family and friends, I'm going to run away and become an astronaut?
Well, I'll give some background to Phil's question. When I was in college, I was a gymnast, and one day I was in my dormitory and the phone rang and the fellow on the other end says, hi, you don't know me, but would you like to work in the circus? And I said, sure. So I did for a summer, which was a pretty interesting job. We traveled around all over New England. I think it was back in college about the same time that, you know, my parents used to kind of say, hello, what are you doing? And then after a time, they just pretty much say, where are you, whenever I call them. So I think when I told them that I was going to apply to be an astronaut and got accepted,